Sorry for the delay. Now, I think now it's time, so let's start today's seminar. The speaker is Fabrizio Lumpinip from CERN. Here to talk about the QCD axion production in the early universe. Please start.
Thanks a lot for the opportunity to give this talk, for the invitation. Yeah, so I will be talking about the QCD axion. I don't know if the pointer, this is the pointer, yes, thank you. And so this talk is it will be mostly based on some recent work that I've done with Alessio Notari and Giovanni Villadoro. He's based in Spain and he's based in Trieste, and this work will soon appear on PRL. This is the kind of the outline of the talk. So I plan to start with some review of the QCD axion and its cosmology. Although my talk will then focus on a specific aspect, which is the possibility to discover or constrain the QCD axion as a light thermal relic. So this will be a specific part of all the ways that we can discover and probe the QCD axion. And then I will describe more in detail the progress that we achieved with our recent work. Okay, so I should say, of course, before even starting, there is a lot of work from the local groups here on the QCD axion, in particular on production in supernovae and other topics. So of course, you know, Korea, you know better than me that the community here is very big on axions. So I'm very happy to talk about this topic here. Okay, so just as a brief, very brief review, although I don't think that maybe for this audience is not necessary. So as you know, the QCD axion is motivated by the strong CP problem of QCD, which can be understood as follows. Essentially, if you look at the Lagrangian of QCD, it contains the terms that are that feature phases. In particular, one is proportional to the G dual. This G is the gluon field strength, and this is the dual of that field strength, and has a parameter theta in front. And then there is a phase here in the mass matrix of the quark. So these are the quark fields, and this is a complex phase. Now, this term here normally would vanish in the sense that can be rewritten as a total derivative of a current J rho. And therefore, if it were not for some specific vacuum property of QCD, this term would vanish and it would not contribute. But actually, in QCD and generally in non-abelian gauge theories, there are topological configurations which are called instantons, by which this term would not vanish. Okay, so this term, in fact, is what leads really to the most interesting phenomenology for the axion. Now, one can reshuffle this phase in the quark mass matrix to the GG dual term by performing a current rotation of the quark fields. And due to the current anomaly, you will remove it from here by doing this rotation. But due to the anomaly, you will shift it to the GG dual term. And so at the end, you are left with a physical parameter theta bar, which is just the difference between the theta appearing here and the theta q appearing here. So that's the only physical parameter in this Lagrangian describing CP violation. And indeed, this term indeed induces CP violation, which can be observed, for example, in the electric dipole moments of the neutron. The electric dipole moment of the neutron, in particular in terms of this theta bar, is given by this expression here. And with current experiments, we are able to bound it to a very precise level to be less than 10 to the minus 26 e per centimeter. And this means that theta bar should be less than 10 to the minus 10. So in short, this is the strong CP problem because you have a parameter in your Lagrangian that has to be very small, but there is no apparent natural reason why this parameter should be small. Okay, now it works here. Okay, so the axion solution is just to promote the theta, that fixed parameter, to a field A, which is called the axion. And as you can see here, the Lagrangian is very simple. It's just the kinetic term plus a coupling to this GG dual term. And then there are possible interaction terms which come with derivatives. They come with derivatives because the theory should be approximately shift symmetric, meaning that if you shift the axion by a constant amount, alpha times f, where this is a dimensionful scale called the axion decay constant, then essentially this is invariant. These are invariant also because in these interactions the axion appears only through derivatives. The only terms that breaks the shift symmetry is this coupling to GG dual. Now, when you do a shift transformation, you see that you can cancel the theta bar term that I was discussing before by appropriately choosing alpha, but then you're indeed left only with the coupling of the axion to GG dual. And now there are interesting results in QCD that tells us that the energy of QCD has a minimum, the vacuum energy of QCD has a minimum, okay, at zero, which means that essentially, and also that it's periodic, the potential, which means essentially that in the early universe, the axion, this field here, will relax to the minimum of the potential, which sits at zero. Now, actually, what I draw before is just a cosine approximation, but actually, if you do a chiral perturbation theory computation, you can compute more precisely the axion potential, you find something that deviates for order one from the cosine approximation. So let me discuss a couple of important properties of the QCD axion. First, the mass. So the axion mass, that is just the potential, is set by IR physics, that is QCD confinement. So essentially, the mass will be proportional to lambda QCD squared over FA, where FA is this dimensionful decay constant, which I will describe in more detail in the next slide. And so for reasons that will be clear soon, the scale should be very large, typically around 10 to the 10 GeV or even larger, which means that the axion mass will be very small, of order milli electron volts or even smaller. It can be a bit larger if F is larger, but in general, it will always be sub-electron volt. Now, there is also the possibility of having a heavy axion. I also worked on this. It's an interesting possibility, but for the sake of this talk, I will stick to the standard QCD axion, which is very light, sub-electron volt particle. So the other important parameter is the axion decay constant FA, which is instead set by UV physics. It's related to the UV completion of the axion effective field theory. And it suppresses all the axion interactions. So these are below the scale of QCD confinement, so below 100 MeV, more or less, 200 MeV. You can see all the interactions are described by this Lagrangian. You can see this is the field strength of photons, so this describes the coupling to photons. You can see that the interaction is, of course, suppressed by FA. These are the derivative interactions that I was mentioning with nucleons and possibly with leptons. However, these interactions with leptons are model dependent. And then you have interactions with mesons, in particular with pions. You see, these are all with the derivatives. Now, due to these interactions, the axion can be produced in very energetic environments, such, for example, as stars. In particular, these are some of the processes that will produce axions in stars. You see, you have external field. You can produce axions through these diagrams. With the interactions with nucleons, you can produce axions via these nucleon-nucleon scatterings. And overall, this leads to some constraints on the axion, which basically tells us that the decay constant should be larger than at least 10 to the 7, 10 to the 8 GeV, possibly even larger if there are coupling to electrons. Now, I want to stress, however, that there are significant uncertainties on these bounds because they are using astrophysical environments such as supernovae, neutron stars, and so on which we have lots of uncertainties. However, it's clear also that there is a bound around these scales. Just which scale exactly is more difficult to determine. Now, let me discuss some UV completion, how typically the axion coupling to QCD is generated. So a simple possibility relies on assuming that there is a complex scalar field of whose phase is the axion. So you see the axion appears as a phase of this complex scalar, and this here is the radial mode. There are other possibilities in extra dimensional theories which are very interesting, but I will not discuss that. You can ask me if you're interested. So there is the so-called KSVZ model, in which essentially you couple this complex scalar to extra fermions psi. These fermions are supposed to be very heavy, much heavier than the standard model fermions, but they are coupled, they are charged under QCD. And since they're charged under QCD, when you perform a rotation of this phi of the fermions, you will also induce, again, for the current anomaly, you will also induce a term in GG dual. Now, the other alternative, which is called DFSZ, instead of adding extra fermions, it adds an extra scalar. So you see that here I have two X doublets, and I couple the complex scalar as follows, phi squared H2HD. In this case, KSVZ, the standard model fermions are not charged under the Pechepin symmetry. In this case, instead, the standard model fermions are charged under the Pechepin symmetry. So this is kind of the crucial difference. In this setup, DFSZ, three-level process will arise with quarks, with standard model process, whereas here, the couplings will only arise at loop level to the standard model. So you see here what happens, of course, when I do rotations of these quarks is, again, I will induce this term GG dual, and this is what generates the coupling. Here, there is a term, there is a parameter NDW, which relates the VEV of this complex scalar phi to the axion decay constant FA. You see, because the axion decay constant is just defined as the interaction strength appearing here, so it's V over NDW. So in general, this means that the axion can have a bigger periodicity than the periodicity of QCD, okay, which is set by 2 pi F, whereas the full periodicity of the axion is 2 pi V. Okay. Again, these are all just details for review. Now, in the early universe, the axion can be produced via two different types of process. One is non-thermal. For example, here I drew the typical non-thermal process is called misalignment mechanism. Essentially, you start in the early universe from some point in this potential. This is just the m squared phi squared potential, but you know it will become a cosine. It's a cosine, but here I'm drawing just close to the minimum. And then at some temperature, the axion will start oscillating the potential, and these oscillations behave like cold dark matter. So this is why the axion is also interesting, because it behaves as cold dark matter. Now, there are also weather thermal processes, which means that in the early universe, you can also produce the axion via scatterings. So at very high temperatures, you can scatter particles, for example, gluons or pions, and these will produce can produce axions if the temperature is high enough. Now, the crucial difference is that in this case, the typical momentum of the axion that is produced is of order of the temperature in the early universe, which is much, much bigger than the axion mass, because I told you that the axion mass is sub-electron volt, and the temperature which we'll be talking about are above 100 MeV. So these axions produced via this process are relativistic, ultra-relativistic, and they are very similar to neutrinos in the way they behave in cosmology. For this reason, they are usually referred to as hot dark matter, exactly like neutrinos. Now, we know from observations that this kind of hot dark matter candidates like neutrinos cannot be the dark matter that we observe, because they would lead to a suppression of structure that we do not observe. So the crucial message here is that the axion generically will make both cold dark matter, but it will also have a hot dark matter population, and we can try to detect it via both populations. In general, indeed, these two populations will coexist. That's what that's just what I was saying. So let me do some brief review of the cold axion. Although again, this talk will not be the main focus of this talk, but I think it's interesting maybe to recap what are the interesting regions of parameter space. So as I was saying, there is the misalignment mechanism, which is just the following: when in the early universe you have the axion potential, and the Hubble rate goes like t squared over m Planck in radiation domination. When the mass of the axion is larger than Hubble, which occurs when the temperature is more or less around GeV, the axion will start oscillating in its potential, and this does behaves like dark matter. So the final abundance of these dark matter axions, omega A is just the relic abundance, meaning the total energy density in axion today divided by the energy density in the universe today, the total energy density today. So as you can see, it's the dark matter abundance today is more or less 26% of what we observe, which means that in order for the axion from misalignment mechanism to be the dark matter, the decay constant should be around 10 to the 11 GeV. And this is the initial value of the axion. So theta is just A over F, okay? It's just the angular variable. And it should be, if it's of order 2, then this is just 0.26%. So this is what explains the dark matter abundance from misalignment. But there are two scenarios now. Either the Pecci-Quinn symmetry is broken during inflation. In this case, the initial value of the axion field is selected by inflation. So, you know, inflation just stretches one Hubble patch, basically selects one particular value of theta. And this means that the axion is homogeneous over the entire Hubble patch today. Alternatively, one can have the Pecci-Quinn symmetry is broken after inflation. In this case, in the Hubble patch at UCD, you will have all different values of theta randomly distributed. And therefore, the average value will be of order 1. So this will not be a free parameter in this case. Okay? This case is free. In this case, it's not a free parameter. So that's for the misalignment contribution. But in axion physics, you also have topological defects. In particular, yes.
Previous slide.
Yes.
In is there any mass range of axion when this misalignment mechanism doesn't work?
Yes. So it doesn't work in reproducing the total dark matter abundance.
No, I'm saying like this misalignment mechanism depends on the potential, the inflationary potential you are taking.
It depends on when you mean when the axion starts oscillating.
Yeah, so like usually axions are masses are very, very small, right?
Yes.
But when you're talking about the axion-like particles, it can be like few MeV or... I mean, there's no mass bound on axion-like particles, right?
Yes. So you're asking me about axion-like, not QCD axion.
Yeah, I'm asking like, is it possible to constrain the... or is it possible to set a limit of axion mass beyond that limit, the misalignment mechanism doesn't work?
Well... so now we go beyond the QCD axion, right? Mm-hmm. When you increase the mass, at some point the axion will be unstable on cosmological scales, which means it will decay. It decays to photons or whatever, right? So in that case, the misalignment mechanism does not work in the sense that it will start, but then it will decay, right? The axion will decay during the cosmological history, so you will not see any relic axion. Now, the precise value of the mass for which this happens, I don't remember.
That's a model dependent.
But it's model dependent, but for sure, MeV axions are unstable. So MeV, if you're talking mega electron volt axion, will decay in the cosmological evolution much before today. That's what I mean. So in that sense, the misalignment mechanism does not work for those because, you know, it will not produce relic axions. Yes?
So the axion doesn't decay to any particle?
The QCD axion does not decay on cosmological timescales because the decay constant is very large. And the mass, so if you want, the decay rate goes like m cubed over f squared. The mass is very small and the f is very large. And so if you compute the decay rate is m cubed over f squared. It's much, much smaller than Hubble today. Because, you know, so it... in that sense, it's not an efficient channel. Okay, so as I was saying, there are also topological defects, which are strings and domain walls. So here, I mean, if you are interested, I can explain more about this, but let me give just a brief picture. Essentially, when you have a complex scalar field with a U1 global symmetry, if you are starting on top of the potential because of thermal effects, so the temperature dependent potential will put you here. Now, once you break the symmetry, you populate the entire field range for the axion. But this means that you will also form in physical space some string-like defects. This means that there is a concentration of energy density in a one-dimensional topological object, which is a cosmic string. So this is common to all theories with U1, spontaneously broken U1 symmetries, not just the Pecci-Quinn, not just the QCD axion, okay? Now, this you produce at very high temperature of order F, so 10 to the 8, 10 to the 10 GeV. Then the universe cools down, and this gas of interacting strings remain there, and it radiates axions continuously. All these axions will contribute to the cold dark matter abundance. Now, once you reach the QCD phase transition, now there is the potential, which, as I was telling you, can have a periodicity which is different from the periodicity of the QCD vacuum. The potential can have a periodicity that is different from the full periodicity of the axion. This was this parameter NDW. So you see here, for example, there are three minima in a full axion periodicity. Now, this means that there are effectively domain walls forming, which separate this vacuum. And these domain walls will be attached to strings, and they will also radiate axions. So essentially, all these processes, the domain walls, once they annihilate, they will contribute to the dark matter abundance. And finally, this is the plot of the parameter space that one gets. So in all the blue region, the axion overproduces dark matter, which means that if you want to produce cold dark matter from the QCD axion, you should lie on the boundary of this blue line. Here, it's mostly due to the misalignment and the strings. And here, it's due to this decay of the domain walls. Now, this is the axion decay constant. And this T star is the temperature at which these domain walls will finally annihilate. This is a kind of a free parameter in general QCD axion model. Here, these are astrophysical bounds on the axion decay constant with their uncertainty. So you see the strongest bound is at 4 times 10 to the 8. The weakest one is at 4 times 10 to the 7. So you see, this is kind of the region that is, these regions here is kind of all allowed, okay? Models with NDW equal 1 will be sitting here, because they don't have stable domain walls, whereas models with NDW larger than 1 will be preferentially sitting here, because the domain walls will generically decay late. Okay, I can talk more about this, but since this was just a review, it's not the main goal of the talk, then if you are interested, you can ask me questions. So this is kind of the general parameter space here in terms of the mass and the coupling to photons of the QCD axion. And here you see all the sensitivities of current and future experiments. These diagonal lines here, DFSZ and KSVZ, are the well-motivated QCD axion lines, which also well-motivated is shaded by changing some parameters such as NDW. So you see here, there is a bound from supernova 1987A, which is the strongest astrophysical bound, but is characterized by some significant uncertainties. And here is where cold dark matter is determined mostly by topological defects. And here is the so-called pre-inflationary QCD action scenario. Okay, so you see that astrophysics gives us an upper bound on the QCD action mass. The mass is inversely proportional to F. So an upper bound on the mass means a lower bound on F. Okay. Now, in this talk, I will describe another strategy. Let me skip this. Another strategy to discover the QCD axion, which is hot axions. So this is the thermally produced population that I was referring to before, produced by scatterings of particles at high temperatures. So this is not the previous cold dark matter axions that I was discussing, but the particle is all, the field is always the same, it's always the QCD axion. Now, in this way, I will be able to set a reliable upper bound on the mass, which is independent of astrophysics. And also, I will discuss how in the future we'll be able to improve on these bounds. Okay, so if there are questions, please feel free to interrupt at any time, but since I'm changing topic now, it's a good time if you have more questions in the first part.
QCD
yes.
Axion will always couple to photon, or
yes,
it's just the consequence of.
So there are two ways to couple. Well, first of all, even if initially it doesn't couple to photons, a coupling to photons will be generated below the QCD crossover. This is typical in KSVZ models. In DFZ models, you can also couple, you can also give UV coupling to photons. So you can explicitly write down a coupling in the UV, and this will give an additional contribution, but there will always be a coupling to photons. Now, it's model dependent because by coupling to the UV, in the UV, you can find ways to make it very small, okay? But they are not the most typical ways, let's say. So there will always be a coupling to photons. Okay. Yeah, so, go ahead.
I'm saying like even if we write a digitilla term,
yes,
like theta digitilla,
yes,
you can draw a two-loop Feynman diagram,
yes,
at the same time, take it to photon.
Yes.
So, even if we're not writing any UV complete model, just theta digitilla.
Yes.
So axiom can always take it to photon in two-loop process. Can
loop and fermion loop, and then it can. Yes, so this is what, so this is the, yeah, I'm talking really that, yeah, the coupling in the below the crossover, below the QCD crossover, you see it's generated precisely by the fact that there is a coupling in the minimal model, there is a coupling only to gluons, but then below the crossover you still generate a coupling to photons. Okay, so now thermal production. This can happen. I will focus on the minimal model. The minimal QCD axion model is coupled only to gluons, only AGG dual. Okay, this is what I will consider. So at very high temperatures above GV, much above GV, you can produce the axion via two scatterings, such as these ones. Okay, where you have gluon fields and then they produce an axion. Below the QCD crossover, that is below 150 MeV, you can produce it instead. The relevant degrees of freedoms are now are not the gluons, but the pions, the mesons. So you can produce it via scattering of pions. And this has been pioneered here in Korea by Chang and Choi in 93, who first performed the computation of the production from pions. Okay. So these are weak coupling processes, which are dominated. The production in this case is always dominated by two scattering processes. But at strong coupling, really close to the crossover, during the crossover, and even at temperatures above the GV, but not too high, in practice, it's not clear what process will lead to production of axions because there is not a weak coupling description. Now, you can see here again, just that, as I was saying, just that the momentum will be much larger than temperature. So what will happen in the early universe is the following. You have a production rate, gamma. Okay, this gamma is just a thermally averaged cross-section. Okay, so this is the cross-section, thermally averaged. And then you, by dimensional analysis at very high temperature, this will go like T cube over F squared, because there is no other, the only scale is F and temperature. So just by dimensional analysis at very high temperatures, this will go like T cube over F squared. And Hubble, during radiation combination, goes like T squared over M Planck. So when you cool down in temperature, at some point, at very high temperatures, the rate is initially much larger than Hubble. In cosmology, when a rate is much larger than Hubble, it means that the process is very effective. So in this region, there will be efficient production of QCD axions, which will be in equilibrium with the standard model bar. At some point, however, the rate will drop below the Hubble rate, which means that the production is not efficient any longer. And so the axions will be completely decoupled from the standard model. There will be no production, and they will be freely streaming, exactly like neutrinos. This means that they redshift like radiation, but they are decoupled from the standard model. So they are really exactly like neutrinos below the scale of neutrino decoupling. This R here is the scale factor in expanding universe. Okay, so it just goes like R to -4. So how can we discover particles that are free streaming and very light? Well, this is this makes use. Typically, we make use of cosmological data sets, in particular of the CMB, because the CMB contains a lot of information about how the universe was at the epoch of recombination, which when the temperature was of order 0.3 electron volts. Now, of course, this is very far from the temperature at which the axion is produced. The axion is produced here at temperature around 100 MeV or even larger. However, since it remains light at CMB epoch, it shows imprints in the CMB. And then, of course, there is also the late universe, such as large-scale structured data, which can be also used to probe structure formation and so on. So the axion would also have an effect on this. Now, in particular, when the mass of the axion is much below 0.1 electron volt, which means that the decay constant is larger than 10, approximately 5 times 10 to the 7 GeV, then you can think of this as contributing to dark radiation, which is typically parameterized in terms of this N effective, the effective number of neutrino species. So this is basically how many species like neutrinos there are in the universe, light species, ultra-relativistic. So 3 is the number of neutrinos, but you could have an additional number, additional species, which is parameterized by this delta N effective, just given by the ratio of the energy density in this dark species divided by the energy density of one neutrino. Now, instead, if the mass is slightly larger than 0.1 electron volts, which can happen when the decay constant is smaller than 5 times 10 to the 7 GeV, then since the temperature of the combination is 0.3 electron volt, then the mass will be of the same order of the temperature of the combination, and so the axion will not really behave as dark radiation, but rather really as a hot dark matter, which is very similar to neutrinos, because neutrinos are thought to have a mass around 0.06 electron volts, maybe up to 0.1 electron volts. So in this case, it will really be very, very similar to neutrinos. And you can see here, this is a plot of the matter power spectrum. It's just the amplitude of the power spectrum of matter at the given scale, K. And the presence of such species leads to a suppression of the power spectrum. So this normalized to a case when there is no light species like this. And you can see that the presence of the species with mass 0.05 electron volts up to 0.5 leads to a suppression of the matter power spectrum. So these are ways that we can probe the existence of these particles. So, okay, this is what I was saying. Essentially, the estimate, the naive estimate for this delta N effective parameter is just given by 0.3 times G star, where G star is the number of light degrees of freedom in the universe at the temperature T. So in the standard model, at very high temperatures, all the particles are massless. Okay, in part, this means that this G star is of order 100. All the particles, quarks, Higgs, fields, vector bosons, everything is massless and contributes to this number G star. And so there are approximately 100 degrees of freedom. Now, once the universe cools down, some particles become massive. For example, at QCD confinement, there is the formation of hadrons. Nucleons, for example, have masses of order 1 GeV, so they will become heavy, non-relativistic, and this number G star will decrease. Eventually, this number G star, the only particle that remains light are neutrinos, that are 3, essentially. So you see here, the later this axion decouples, TD is the temperature of decoupling of the axion when gamma becomes of order H, the bigger the contribution of delta N effective will be. And in particular, here you see a plot of delta N effective as a function of the temperature at which the QCD axion decouples. And here is G star, this number of degrees of freedom that I was telling you. So you see at very high temperature, this is in MeV, so this is 100 GeV, the number of the G star is order 100. But then you see that it decreases sharply, and delta N effective increases very sharply around the QCD crossover, which is 1 GeV. So currently, with Planck data, CMB data plus baryon acoustic oscillations, we are able to constrain any species that decoupled below 100 MeV because we set delta N effective to be less than 0.3 at 2 sigma. In the future, with Simon's observatory, we'll be going down to 0.1 in delta N effective, and eventually with CMB stage 4 in the 2030s, we'll go down even more to 0.06 at 2 sigma. So you see, we will be able to probe axion decoupling slightly below 1 GeV. And the caveats on this computation that I was doing and plotting here are the following. This will be important for the rest of this talk. Essentially, when when cross sections depend on momentum, which will typically be the case, this formula cannot really be used as it is, because higher momenta, higher axial momenta will decouple later. And when the number of degrees of freedom decreases rapidly, such as is the case here, higher momenta will be less diluted. I will explain this better in the next slides. So the whole goal of the rest of this talk is to show that this estimate is not reliable and that one has to improve it in the way that I will show. Now, for the sake of this talk, I will also mostly focus on production below the QCD crossover, where the rate is due to scattering with pions and goes like. So now here I cannot apply the simple dimensional analysis estimate of T cube over F squared, because there is another scale that is the pion decay constant. Pions coupled via the pion decay constant. So now we will have F A squared, F pi squared, and then by dimensional analysis, I can only put T to the 5 here. So this is the typical dimensionful rate, the typical dimension, scales that enter in the rate of production from pions. Okay? So for the sensitivity of current experiments, this is the most important process. For the future, this process will be most important, and I will show at the end how things can change. Okay, so let me discuss the production from pions, unless you have questions. If you have questions, it's a good time to ask. Okay, if there are no questions, let me discuss production from pions. So the Lagrangian describing axion and pion interactions in current perturbation theory is given is the current Lagrangian given by the following. So you see there are pion fields and the axion fields with the derivative. And there is a coefficient epsilon here, which is an isospin, encodes an isospin suppression. You see it's proportional to the mass of the difference of the mass of the up quark and the down quark. And there is a C3 term, which is a model-dependent UV coupling. So this is if you couple also in the UV to quarks, like in the FSZ model. But in this talk, I will set this term to zero and focus on the model-independent coupling. Now, you can compute the scattering amplitude from this Lagrangian, and you will find that it's given by the following. So it increases like S squared. And therefore, as I was saying, it increases rapidly with momenta. Now, this has been used since the 90s to compute this axion production in the early universe up to 200 MeV in temperature. However, there is an important caveat. It is that in the early universe, you can think, so in the early universe, there is a thermal bath. So particles have an energy that is due to temperature. And in particular, the average energy of a pion will be at the temperature of, for example, 100 MeV, is already above 300 MeV. So you see here, at the temperature slightly below 150 MeV, the energy of a single pion, average energy of a single pion in the thermal bath, already crosses the three-level unitarity bound on scattering of pions. So now, if you take into account that there are two pions, you need two pions to produce the axion, you will see that you will violate this unitarity bound at much lower temperature, typically less than 100 MeV, which means that this computation cannot really be trusted because chiral perturbation theory is not reliable in this range. And this has been recently pointed out also quantitatively by these authors who have computed the rate at next to leading order and showed in current perturbation theory, and showed that there are large corrections already below 100 MeV. Additionally, you see that the number of degrees of freedom, G star that I was talking about, is very rapidly varying with temperature here. You see, these are 150. We are interested mostly in the regime below 150 MeV. So you see that this is a rapidly varying quantity. So for all these reasons, you cannot trust the simple estimate that I was showing before. So one reason has to do with the rate, the fact that the current perturbation theory rate is not reliable. So how do we fix this issue? We look at a lesson from pions. In fact, in pion scattering, this issue is very well known since the 90s or even before. In this beautiful series of papers by Goethe, Lotwiller, and Schenk and others, people were computing exactly the thermal scattering of pions. So now let's replace the axion with the pion, okay? So I'm talking just about pion-pion scattering, no axion now. So in this plot taken from this paper, you can see that chiral perturbation theory at second order, which means next to leading order, would give for the forward scattering amplitude, it would give this dashed line. So you cannot really see here, but basically what you can see here is that it explodes at high center of mass energies. It keeps growing and growing. This is simply because, as we know, chiral perturbation theory is not reliable above certain of mass energies. However, if you look at data, because for pion-pion scatterings, we can do experiments and check the amplitude, so with the phase shifts, then you obtain this shaded gray region, which goes up, but then goes down, essentially, okay? So it does not explode at high center of mass energies. So this is the so-called phenomenological analysis derived using phase shifts from pion scattering experiments. So then what people do in pion scatterings, they do a decomposition into isospin channels, 0, 1, and 2, you see? And they expand into partial waves. And the inelastic region below center of mass energies below 1 GeV, unitarity implies that you can write these partial waves TIL in terms of phase shifts delta IL. And then people look at the data for these phase shifts. So you see, this is, for example, the S0 wave, which is delta 00 phase shift. So you see, these are the data, and then people do fits on this data. Okay, this is the P wave, and this is the S2 wave, the data and the fits. So the lesson here is that what people do for pions is to look at the data, then they make phenomenological fits, and from those they derive a phenomenological amplitude. So the amplitude, they do not compute it from first principle, but just from data, okay? And then they compute this probability, this rate of destruction of a pion in the thermal bath. But okay, this is a more technical thing. I will come back to this at the end. Now, the important thing is that if you look at the rate, this is the thermally average rate in the thermal bath. You see the leading order chiral perturbation theory result is the dashed line, blue line, which goes up with temperature, whereas the result of this phenomenological analysis goes up, but then it goes down. So it's significantly larger than the chiral perturbation theory result, but then at high temperature it goes down. And this is just a manifestation that this process is not violating unitarity, if you want. But also that there are other channels that are opening up, because as you go at higher temperatures, you can produce via scattering with kaons, nucleons, many other things. And so pions will not be the leading channel any longer at high temperatures. Okay, so what we did, our strategy for axion pion now, relies on a crucial point, that is, it's a trick if you want, is to notice that as you know, the pion, in the presence of an axion, there is an axion-pion mixing. This is the reason why in the chiral Lagrangian, the axion and the pions interact, if you want. There is an axion-pion mixing. In other words, the pion contains a physical pion field, but it also contains an axion component, A, with a mixing angle theta A pi, which is just given by this expression here. So it's a very small angle because it's suppressed by F pi over F A. The pion decay constant is of order 100 MeV, and the axion decay constant is of order 10 to the 10 GeV. So this is a very, very tiny mixing angle, which governs the axion pion mixing, okay? So essentially, by noticing that this is true, one can relate the amplitude of pion-pion scattering here to the amplitude of axion pion scattering via multiplying by the mixing term. So it's a rescaling of the amplitudes that we do. Now, of course, the pion is massive. It has a mass around 140 MeV, whereas the axion is massless. So there will be difference due to the pion mass, proportional to the pion mass. But these differences are very tiny because they come as m pi squared over s, and s is much larger than m pion in the region of interest. Okay. So by doing this procedure, we found basically the same story that I was showing before for pion. So this is the leading order color perturbation theory result, and this is the phenomenological rate. Now, this is the rate as a function of temperature, whereas this is the rate of destruction of a pion, of an axion. So meaning what we are interested in actually, as I will show shortly, is not just the total rate, but it's the rate for every axion momentum, so for every axion mode. So as a function of the energy of the axion in units of the pion mass. Okay, this feature is the same. So you see it explodes, the rate at leading order in current perturbation theory explodes, but the phenomenological rate does not explode. Okay, so this is the first part. Now, the second part has to do with the spectral distortions. In other words, why did I tell you that we are interested in the rate as a function of momentum k rather than the total rate? Because when you have dependence on momentum k, okay, this is axial momentum ka, then different momenta can decouple at different times. So this is what's shown in this plot. You see, you can have that a momentum, an axial momentum ka much larger than ka2 decouples much later, crosses Hubble much later than the KA2 would, okay? And now, in the presence of a varying G star, like is the case for us, the dilution of the energy density in axions at this temperature will be proportional to G star to the minus 1/3. And so if you decouple later, you see a smaller value of G star. You see, if I decouple, let's say, at 100 MeV, I see 17 as a value. But if I decouple at 150, then I will see 25. And this affects the scale factor, and it affects the dilution due to redshift, the redshift of the energy density. So this, in other words, this means that for axions, we expect a spectral distortion, which means that instead of having an equilibrium Bose-Einstein distribution of axions, we will have something that is shifted to larger momenta, because larger momenta are less diluted compared to low momenta. So in order to do this, in order to assess this, we need to solve a momentum-dependent Boltzmann equation. This is the first time that this is done in the literature for the QCD axion, rather than a Boltzmann equation for the yield. So you see, this is the axion distribution function, FP, and these are creation and destruction rates of an axion in the thermal bath. And from here, once we know the axion distribution function, then we integrate over momenta to obtain the total energy density, and from here we compute delta n effective. So that's the strategy, these two ways to assess these two problems. So if you have questions on this, I can answer now. Otherwise, I will show you the results of our analysis. Okay, yes.
The discrepancy between this chiral perturbation theory and the experiment is only for this chiral perturbation breaking, not for the thermal correction.
For the thermal corrections, what do you mean?
You are calculating in the thermal background.
Yes.
That is perfectly have been understood.
Oh, so are you saying like corrections to? Right, so I think you're saying that we are computing scattering amplitudes as if they were at zero temperatures, and then we thermal average in the bath. I think your question is whether this is correct, whether we should compute an amplitude which includes thermal corrections. Okay, so for pions, for scattering with pions, this is shown to be not a relevant effect, so this concern that you have. But for example, for scattering from gluons, this is essential. So if you would scatter gluons, then it would be essential to take into account thermal corrections to the scattering rate. Yes, but for pions, it's not so important. That's a very good question. I mean, this in principle we worried about this. There can be correction to the mass, thermal correction to the mass, and so on. But below 150 MeV, they are subleaving.
What's the reason?
Basically, so the reason why they are subleading, So you could have, for example, thermal correction to the pion mass, and they will become very large once you approach the QCD crossover. The width of the pion is the same order of the mass, so it means that the pion is not even there in the thermal bath. So we stay at temperatures below those temperatures. But yeah, if you would push this thing even farther, then you would encounter all these problems that make the S3 completely unreliable. But I think your question is very interesting because in principle, there are some papers on pion scatterings, so not axion, on pion scatterings, including thermal correction to the mass. And my understanding is that this gives subleading corrections. But I think it would be interesting to look at this in more detail. This is an interesting thing to look at. You wanted to ask?
You consider three pion going to one axion process, but why do you consider the two pion axion process? Like, is it possible to...
No. How? Let's see. No, you see in the Lagrangian, you have three pions, one axion. So this is the leading process. Then, you saw you remember the axion Lagrangian. Sorry. This was the axion pion, you see, so there is three pions and the axion, it's kind of the leading process. Then you know, then when you go to next to leading order and so on and so forth, but indeed, you see, once the next to leading order corrections become large, it just means that the whole perturbation theory expansion, you cannot use it, right? So this is why we had to resort to a phenomenological analysis. And this phenomenological analysis, if you want, includes all the possible channels, because this is just based on the data, right? So it includes all the possible production channels from pions.
What if it interacts with the lepton?
Leptons are not included here because those coupling with leptons are model dependent. So in some models like DFSZ, you can couple to leptons and you would produce more axions or less. I mean, it's model dependent. Now it depends. With leptons, I can show you at the end if you want. I also worked on this in the past. You can have production with leptons, photons. So you in the case, the process also involves photons. But yeah, you can definitely produce axions also via muons, for example, or tau scatterings.
You just wanted to consider pion just because you're interested to decouple the axions in the MAV scale.
So if you want, there are two reasons. First is that decoupling to pion is always there, even in the minimal model KSVZ, is always there, the decoupling to pions. The other reason is that decoupling to leptons will not give the dominant bound. So, for example, you can consider a production from muon scatterings. This will give a weaker bound than the one we found, because scattering process with leptons are suppressed by the lepton mass, whereas the coupling, the one with the, you know, this will give a dominant contribution to the axion rate if it's there. Okay, now it's always there. Except that, of course, you see here, there is some model dependence also in this process, because I'm focusing on the model independent contribution, epsilon. But if you have a UV coupling to quarks, you see that here it comes with a minus sign. So you could cancel this. But this model is model dependent now, right? In some models, you can cancel you can reduce the interactions via pions. Yeah. Okay, so let me go to the results of the analysis. So the results are the following. So we computed, these are our results for delta N effective as a function of the axion mass. The result is the boundary of the blue curve. So I want to show some important aspects of this plot. First, if you do not solve the momentum dependent Boltzmann equation with momentum dependent rates, you would obtain the dotted curve. Whereas solving with the correct momentum-dependent equations, you obtain the blue curve here, which is an enhancement of approximately 40% with respect to the other rate, okay? So it's important to include momentum dependence. Now, the issue of spectral distortion can be understood by looking at the distribution function, okay? So this is the distribution function, the blue one, solid blue, is the one we found by solving the Boltzmann equation, okay? For this value of the axion decay constant. Whereas the dotted one is the Bose-Einstein distribution, which has the same energy density. So the integral below these two curves is the same. But you see that the Bose-Einstein distribution is shifted to lower momenta. This means that our numerical solution with respect to the equilibrium distribution is shifted to higher momenta. For this reason, we talk of spectral distortion. Okay, this is what I was saying before. Now, if I now use the Planck 18 plus BAO constraint on massless species, which is 0.28 at 2 sigma, I would conclude that the axion mass should be somewhat smaller than what's shown in this bound here. However, actually, to be more precise, given that the mass is around the temperature of recombination, you see it's around 0.2 electron volts, what one needs to do is a dedicated fit in the cosmological data, the CMB and BAO data, which is what we did. So we did a fit, we implemented this into class, and we did a fit into a fit to CMB data, also including varying neutrino masses. And we found the following bound, at 2 sigma, 0.20, the axion mass should be less than 0.24 electron volts. This corresponds to this star here in this plot. So this is our bound with our new analysis. Now, in the near future, very near future, in fact, there is a very positive outlook on this detection strategy for axions. The reason is the following. If you look at the sensitivity in the next few years, which will be achieved via Simon's Observatory, DESI, and Euclid, you see that we will go down to delta n effective order 0.1. And if you look even farther with CMB stage 4 in the 2030s, we will go down even farther. So now you see that the temperatures that we will be probing for axion production will be between 150 and 500 MeV, which is really when the QCD crossover phase transition occurs. So in this regime, we cannot use pion production because, as we were just saying, at that point, pions do not really exist any longer, right? It's all kind of a thermal bath of hot gluons, non-perturbative, essentially, very strongly coupled. So we have to find a way to go beyond pion scattering and compute the rate at the QCD crossover, where a non-perturbative calculation will be needed for upcoming sensitivities. Now, I can show here what we did with a tentative dimensional analysis estimate, just to get an idea of what could be potentially constrained or discovered by future surveys. If I use dimensional analysis to estimate the rate above 150 MeV, just T cube over F squared, with kappa being a numerical coefficient, for example, between 0.01 and 0.1. Then I would get the following curves, the dashed purple curve. And now if I compare with the sensitivity reach of future surveys, you see that we could improve the bound on the axion mass very significantly from this 0.24, that is what we were able to set now, to possibly 0.05 electron volts, or even beyond 0.01, essentially, electron volt, or even beyond, because this does not actually include the fact that the axion has a mass, plus the fact that there is a spectral distortion also above 150 MeV. So overall, yes, but kappa is not model dependent. It's just because this is just dimensional analysis, yes. So we don't know what the coefficient should be. We can have some guess based on so-called Sphaleron rates that have been studied in other contexts, by also in the context of the QCD axion by Shaposhnikov et al. But also there are recent studies by Surjit, for example, in the context of dark energy for warm inflation. But in the context of axion production, these rates have not yet been estimated. So we don't know really what this coefficient should be. For this reason, we vary between 0.01 and 0.1. It could be larger or smaller. So if it's smaller, then the curve will go in this direction. If it's larger, in this direction. So this is an uncertainty that we cannot quantify at the moment. Okay, so basically, the bottom line of this talk is the following, that we were able now to establish the new conservative hot dark matter bound on the axion, which sits right in the region, right in the middle of the region that is constrained by astrophysics. However, again, I should stress that this bound is obtained without astrophysical uncertainty. So this only relies on the CMB, which is a much more precise data set than the astrophysical observation of supernovae. So future bound or detection even of axion could lie anywhere in this region. Eventually, if we are able to really probe very small value of delta ineffective, we will be able to cover the full axion parameter space. But of course, this is up to the sensitivity of the detectors. So I only showed what we know will are the forecasted sensitivity reaches of detectors up to 2030s. Yeah, so this is the conclusion. Let me just leave it here because more or less is what I already said in the plot. Okay, thank you. And sorry if I took too long.
I just have a maybe.
Yes.
I missed that. So the axion mass versus coupling plot, the previous one. So the CMB temperature scale is around 0.3 electron volt.
Yes.
But when you're talking about this 0.5 e electron volt mass or more than that,
yeah.
At the time CMB, it's already non-relativistic, right?
It's basically. Yeah, it's basically almost totally non-relativistic.
So not contribute to delta ineffective because it's not
anymore. So in all this region here, the axion is not really contributing to ineffective. It contributes more, I mean, it depends on how you define ineffective, right? Here we plot ineffective just as a useful parametrization of the axion energy density. But physically, the axion, as you said, is already a bit non-relativistic. So actually, is you know, it behaves really as hot dark matter. So it's already some kind of dark matter, but it's more hot than the standard cold dark matter. So it's like a neutrino, you know. Neutrinos also are thought to have a mass around 0.1 electron volt. So also neutrinos are not ineffective, technically speaking.
At the time of CMB, it's still relativistic because it's like at the same scale.
Exactly. Yeah, here, if you go to very large scales, so to much larger mass at 10 electron volts and so on, yeah, then it's totally non-relativistic. It's what people still call this warm dark matter or non or hot dark matter, yes, depending. Yeah. But you're right, this is just a useful parametrization. In this mass range, it does not actually behave as dark radiation. It's really hot dark matter.
Okay, now let's next
explore
again. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.